card by Wheeling National Bank. All the bank you'll ever need. By Simon's Furniture, Simon's Thomasville Gallery, and Simon's Carpet Town of Weirton. And by Palomino Ford of Wellsburg, where every day is a sales day. And by Advanced Federal Savings and Loan, with offices in Wellsburg and Follinsby. And by Saxon Jewelers, downtown Steubenville and Fort Steuben Mall.
George, it's been quite a football season for Ohio Valley teams. Out of the Ohio Valley Athletic Conference alone, two state champions in the state of West Virginia and one runner-up in the state of Ohio in Division II. That is quite an accomplishment.
Well, it really was an unbelievable year. Probably the most successful year we've ever had in the Valley, Bob. 2-13-0 state champions. And certainly the great performance by Steubenville, better than 143 out of 144 teams in that division in Ohio. And you can attribute it to the great schedules that these three teams played. This year, as opposed to past years, Bob, we had more good football teams in the Ohio Valley. In the past, you would have a handful of quality clubs. This year, we had maybe 20. And you had a lot of teams turn around disastrous 1986 seasons to have big years in 87. For example, Mingo went from an 0-10 to a 7-3. JU was 2-8 in the OVAC cellar last year, turned that completely around, went to the playoffs this year. A number of other teams, Union Local, 7-3. Madonna, in winning a state championship, went from a 3-7 to a 10-0. So what you had is a greater competitive balance, more parity, and that helped prepare these teams to go on and perform as they did in the postseason.
TV7 Sports invites you to join us for the next 60 minutes for Mark of a Champion, where we'll take a look at our three teams that made it to the title game in their respective states, plus a look at many of the other OVAC teams. Don't go away.
The 1987 Brook Bruins no doubt turned in their finest performance on the football field during this past season as they compiled a perfect 13-0 record and captured their second Class AAA title in the past 3 years. However, during the offseason, few people could have foreseen the success this team was about to enjoy. During that offseason, the Bruins had to live with slightly battered egos after falling to Stonewall Jackson 17-14 in the 1986 AAA championship game at Laidley Field in Charleston. The offseason conditioning and strength program was crucial as the Bruins prepared to reload.
I felt that if they would come back and work hard, and we would work hard, and together try to make something out of it, we could be a decent football team. We had one offensive tackle coming back on the offensive front, and literally, that's it. The other offensive tackle had to be moved to a defensive end position. We had two good running backs coming back. We felt that if anything, if we could make some holes for some people, we had two kids that had played and ran on a very quality offensive football team. It's just that they, you know, coming into the season, were probably more productive last year because of the simple fact that we could throw the ball so well. And we had no idea that we were going to be able to throw the ball as well as we did this year, especially having to go through, you know, the quarterback change, you know, via injury and what have you. But I got to give our guys a lot of credit. We came in with the same philosophy that we had done in the last 2 years and ended up doing the same things that we had done in the last 2 years in terms of running the ball and throwing the ball. We were very productive, both in the air and on the ground this year.
There was optimism during the August preseason drills, but the coaching staff knew there was a great deal of work to be done before this team would function as a cohesive unit.
Okay, that's good, that's good, that's good, that's good, that's good, good, good. I like that.
The Bruins opened the 1987 season at perennial state playoff contender Parkersburg and escaped with a tense 10-8 victory over the Big Reds.
The game eventually boiled down to them missing about a 38-yard field goal by about 3 to 5 yards, and as one of our coaches, Ronnie Paul, said, that's probably the biggest 5 yards of the season for us. And, you know, had we lost that game on that field goal, you know, what would this team have done? We really can't answer that because we've talked as a staff, how would this team experience the loss? How could they have come back and handled something like that? Because, you know, they're out of a program that's used to winning and what have you. What could they have done? Could they have been anything like the 85 team, you know, that walked off the field and said, we're going to win it all?
They may have answered that question 1 week later as the heavily favored Lebos of Mount Lebanon marched into Wellsburg.
I've said it all along. We can play football with anybody. The Brook Bruins proved that tonight with an impressive 21-12 win over the number 3 ranked Quad A team from Western Pennsylvania, Mount Lebanon. Bruins' first possession. It's quarterback Jimmy Mirasola with a pitch back to Raleigh Mason. He'll bring it to the Mount Lebanon 47 and a first down. Same play. Mason charging down inside the 15. Might as well try it again. Touchdown. Tommy Mazzone boots it through to make it 7-0. The visitors were impressive the rest of the half. One score came on this connection from Scott Clements to Dan Prunzik. And Mount Lebanon went in front 12-7. But the Bruins' young defense held the Blue Devils in check. And a third quarter score pushed Brook in front 13-12 going to the fourth. After Mirasola was shaken up, they called on junior quarterback Charlie Basil and saddled up Kevin Komorowski. Finally, fourth and goal at the one. Komorowski, yeah, he got there. And the Bruins did it.
Our kids knew the magnitude of the game. They felt that that was a big feather in their cap. They felt that going out and displaying themselves against a quality football team, a quality program out of a league rich with tradition, I think that that was a big step forward.
Any thoughts that the Bruins would flatten out from that big victory were quickly dispelled as they won very impressively the following week at John Marshall. They cruised through the middle part of their schedule with victories over Parkersburg South, Fairmont West, and Oakland. All of a sudden, the Bruins were becoming the team to beat in this part of the state.
I kept telling them, fellas, all of a sudden, we're going to be the big guy on the block. Everybody in the valley is going to want to knock you off. Now, we're going to have to be like Mike Tyson. We're going to have to go into the ring every doggone week, and you're going to have to be ready to put them up and fight back.
They did. The Bruins trailed Greenbrier West by 2 TDs at the half and came storming back to win. The following week, they faced a much improved Wheeling Park team who brought a 6-1 record into that game at Wheeling Island Stadium. And for the third time this season, the Bruins stopped their opponents cold in the second half and came from behind to win. By now, it was evident that the Bruins possessed that special intangible of being able to come from behind. After a victory at Wintersville in Game 9, the Bruins found themselves on the threshold of something that had never been achieved in their rich history. Brook equipment manager Dave Kukaris summed it up this way.
We're one game away from a perfect season, and we're 3 games away from a dream.
The Bruins had a surprisingly easy time with the Red Riders of Weir, who came into the game on a 4-game winning streak. On to the playoffs.
Our preparation in all 3 games was exciting. It was really great. There were 3 great weeks of work in terms of not so much intensity, but in terms of learning the opposition and being able to deal with whatever we're going to have to deal with.
The Bruins dealt Ripley a 42-17 pasting at Wheeling Island Stadium to advance to the semifinal round against Charleston. On a day when the arctic conditions put the offenses into the deep freeze, the contest came down to breaks and a will to survive. Early in the fourth quarter of a scoreless game, Charleston's Travis Ramseur shocked the Bruins with his 62-yard interception return for a touchdown and a 7-0 Mountain Lion lead. The Bruins got their big break a short time later when Jimmy Kohut blocked a punt and Mike Cecini recovered at the Charleston 20, and that set up the tying touchdown.
We ended up having to go at him instead of around him, because of the simple fact that the conditions for us was getting worse as the game went on, and we're running the option game and things like that, which has been a big part of our game all year long, and we're throwing the ball well, and because of the field conditions and the wind conditions, our throwing game wasn't good, so what we had to do was try to play field position with them.
Brook gained crucial field position late in the game when John Brown intercepted a Charleston pass in Mountain Lion territory. That set the stage for Kevin Komorowski's touchdown run, which propelled the Bruins to that dream matchup in the championship game against top-ranked and undefeated Stonewall Jackson. Even the weather cooperated for this title game at Laidley Field in Charleston. Some 9,000 fans enjoyed the game on a 60-plus degree afternoon. Only the Brook fans enjoyed it more.
Our defense went in and just played probably their most stellar performance. Dave Riley said this. He says, Coach, I think of Charleston, we could have made our best defensive showing. He says, today was the best.
The unheralded key to all three Bruin playoff victories was the play of their special teams. A block punt set up the first score against Ripley. Another block punt set up the tying touchdown against Charleston. And the Bruin kicking game kept Stonewall at bay in poor field position all afternoon. In fact, the Generals crossed the Brook 28-yard line only once. After a fumble recovery by the Bruins in the second quarter, Raleigh Mason bowled in for the go-ahead touchdown. Mason, who had rushed for over 1,500 yards during the season, had given the Bruins all they would need. Brook went on to defeat Stonewall 12-0, capturing their second AAA title in the past 3 years. Brook fans now look ahead to the future and the opening of their new 8,000-seat facility, which is located on the school grounds.
Only the names will change. The numbers will remain the same. The colors will remain the same. We're just going to have a chance to do our thing in a different location and just kind of carry tradition on, you know, on a new set of fields and grasses and stadiums and things like that.
Madonna's march to the Class A championship was the great success story of 1987. Midway through the 86 season, the state capital probably seemed about as far away as another planet. The 86 team was comprised of mostly underclassmen who were experiencing growing pains. Toward the end of that difficult 3-7 campaign, a light began to appear at the end of the tunnel. Through the first six games, the powerful Lindsley defense had not allowed a touchdown. The Blue Dons were the first to dent the scoreboard against the Cadets, and despite a loss there, the Dons closed out the season with two wins. 16 seniors returned for the 1987 season, and they had a commitment to make the playoffs. Few people outside the Madonna program thought that goal was realistic, but the Blue Don staff believed that if they were able to develop a couple of key areas, that goal was indeed attainable.
I felt our offensive line, you know, if we could just see the picture up front, and I think I said that a couple times early in the year, that it seemed like they were seeing the picture a lot better. And if you don't have those guys that can make the holes, then you're going to be in trouble. And we thought that that was one major area of improvement, that when those guys came up to the line of scrimmage, if they knew what we were trying to do and they could execute, we'd be in great shape.
The Blue Dons rolled impressively through the first half of their regular season schedule. By this, their third game at St. John Central, they had come of age as a football team. Their awesome performance against the Irish skyrocketed them from out of the top 15 in statewide polls to the number one position. The keys to their success, however, can be traced to games one and two. Game one was a victory over AAA Oak Glen.
We played Oak Glen, you know, tough the last five, 6 years. It seems like we always came up on the short end, though, but we conditioned really hard. In the summertime and, you know, all through the school year, we have a total conditioning program for our athletes, and we conditioned very hard. And when it came down to the fourth quarter, we were ready in the Oak Glen game.
Game number two was a visit to Sistersville to meet the three-time defending champion Tigers. On that night, Madonna became the first Class A team in a decade to beat the Tigers in their Temple of Doom. It was a great confidence builder.
Especially being down 9-0 right off the bat down there, and we didn't panic, our kids didn't panic. Usually when you're down 9-0 down that place, you're down, you're done. But our kids didn't panic, we didn't panic, and all we did was we just chipped away, and then all of a sudden we kind of exploded. And yeah, on the way back on the bus, we were kind of saying, as coaches, we were saying, well, if we just keep this kind of thing under control, we're going to be all right.
The second half of the regular season was brutal. In this game number nine, the Dons held off a game and worthy Mingo team And to get to this point, they had come off big wins against Bishop Donahue, which had playoff aspirations, and a game at Winbur, Pennsylvania, a strong program with a AAA size enrollment. The playoffs almost seemed like a break after their exhausting trek through an unbeaten regular slate, which ended with a win over AA playoff contender Frankfurt.
By the time we got to the playoffs, we felt with our schedule and the teams, the competition that we played, that we were ready. We weren't going to see anybody that was going to be any better than any of the teams that we saw our first 10.
The Blue Dons had been in the playoffs on two other occasions, but had never tasted victory. They let Mullins know early in the quarterfinal that Madonna was no mirage, but the real thing. The ground attack, which had rolled up over 3,000 yards over the course of the year, was in full throttle. You just never knew which of the quick, talented ball carriers was coming at you. The thing that impressed you most about this club was their ability to rise to every occasion. When these kids said they were going to do something, they did it. Mullins scored a touchdown in the final minute of the half to pull within 22-6. But the 49 seconds they left on the second period clock was plenty enough. David Oseba put the fork in them with a 67-yard romp. Home field advantage would obviously be a big factor in Madonna's pursuit for a state title.
It was even more of an advantage against Moorfield with the weather conditions the way they were. We had a ton of people up there screaming for us, and it was, you know, cold, you know, chilly, snow flurries and stuff like that. And that really makes the kids feel warm inside when you got your fans back and you screaming and yelling and stuff like that. Yeah, it's nice to be at home.
Yep, Mullins was history. And the only thing standing between Madonna and a meeting with Mate One were two other things starting with M, Moorfield and Mother Nature. Chill factors were below zero and the field was snow-capped. None of this seemed to faze the Dons. Quarterback Jason Backle threw a pair of touchdown passes to Brian Maley, and the Blue Don defense stuffed Moorfield in all but one drive. Backle's leadership was extremely evident here, because few quarterbacks could general an offense as efficiently in such miserable conditions.
A veer option quarterback on our level in high school, better than I've ever seen it done. He's a leader, he's got heart, he's a gentleman, and whatever he's going to do in life, he's going to do it well.
And so it was. The Dons had a date with destiny on Laidley Fields turf the evening of November 28th. Here are some of the sights and sounds of that memorable evening.
Let's get fired up! Let's get fired up!
On the outlaw, now we got it. Remember, if we're going outlaw, we got to contain it.
This David Burns run of 66 yards, a record setter in Class A championship competition, all but sealed Madonna's first state championship.
I thought our key in the championship game was the fact that we were quicker than they were.
Madonna was far more dominant than the final score indicated. They piled up nearly 400 yards total offense, and all that was left now was one big celebration.
Our motto this year was reawakening the tradition. And what we did was we woke it up. And Madonna's had an excellent Class A football program in the past, in the 60s and 70s, under Krivak, under Miller. And we were ready to do it again. And hopefully these kids that we have now, the younger kids and maybe some of the kids that thought they were going to come out but didn't and stuff like that, yeah, get them out. We'll take them.
Of the 88 boys at Madonna High School, 40 of them participated on this team. That says something about how their staff makes it fun. It was even fun when they were 3-7, but a whole lot of fun to be 13-0.
We'll be right back.
The only Ohio Valley football team to ever play for an Ohio State championship is Steubenville Big Red. In 1984, Steubenville achieved perfection, winning its first Division II title in a heart-stopping 12-9 overtime thriller against Columbus Whitehall. In 1985, they almost made it to Columbus again, but were upended in the final seconds on a field goal by Youngstown Cardinal Mooney. In 1986, a rebuilding year. But rebuilding years for this outstanding program can mean 10-0 regular seasons, which is exactly what they were as they headed to the Rubber Bowl in Akron for another postseason appearance against Worcester. The Big Red did not fare well that night, but virtually the entire squad would gain valuable experience from this loss as they looked ahead to the 1987 season.
We had to get physically stronger, and you know, we just had to improve in certain areas of our game, and I think that that set the tone mentally for our season in 87.
Big Red opened the campaign at home against Cleveland South. After South surprised Big Red with an early touchdown pass, Reno's gang gave the capacity home turnout a sample of what the 87 season would be all about. They won going away against the Cleveland South team, which would eventually go on to win the Cleveland City League title. In week number two, Big Red took to the highway for its only road game of the year. They played poorly and were beaten by Warren Harding. Some valuable lessons, however, were learned from this setback.
I think that the loss to Warren Harding was a blessing in disguise. I think that sometimes your teams sort of tend to live off the reputation of the past teams. And it's very important that your teams want to add to the tradition of your school and not just be a part of the tradition. And that loss to Warren Harding sort of knocked a couple of our players on their back. And they sort of realized that, hey, I'm not going to be that good unless I work. And we had tremendous work weeks, the 3 or 4 weeks after that. But the key to our season was the fourth quarter against Dover. I believe that when we were losing to Dover in the fourth quarter, had we gone 1-2, our season would have been a disaster because we would not have been sure of what we're doing.
After the narrow win over Dover, Big Red knocked off Cleveland West Tech, which was the runner-up in the Cleveland City League this year. Steubenville began a string of wins, where they were jumping on top of the opposition in the first half, but had not yet found that killer instinct. They built an insurmountable first half lead and a victory over Weirton October 2nd. And then arch rival Wintersville invaded Harding Stadium for what would be an epic battle on October 10th. Once again, Big Red jumped out in front 14-0 in a downpour, but the Golden Warriors stormed back in the second half to tie the game and force it into overtime. Steubenville survived 28-27 in a wild, controversial finish. After disposing of East Liverpool and Warrensville Heights, they were put to the test by the other arch rival, Central Catholic. Again, Big Red grabbed the early lead 21-0, but the always scrappy Crusaders refused to be blown away, and the final score was 21-8. Big Red was now eyeing a 9-1 regular season and home field advantage for the first round of the playoffs. A little momentum wouldn't hurt either.
But I'd say our best total effort, complete effort during the regular season, was the Youngstown East game. I think that's what propelled us into the playoffs.
DeSales came from the capital city. What they received at Harding Stadium this evening was capital punishment. Big Red's nightmare defense hung them, and the offense gassed them. For better than a quarter, every yard gained by both offenses meant something. DeSales finally got on the board with a 21-yard field goal by Dan Sprout, which made it 3-0. Their lead lasted approximately 12 seconds. This is Tubbo Yetz on the return.
I just saw fire in the kids' eyes. You know, I knew that they weren't quitting, down 3-0. So, you know, why should I quit? You know, they're young kids, 17 years old. Here I am, 38 years old. I figured I better get on the march, too. When he broke that one out, you know, we were on our way. And they weren't stopping us after that kickoff return.
DeSales fumbled on its first play after the ensuing kickoff, and Big Red is knocking on the door once again. Dunrick Yetz needs 6 inches for the touchdown. Finally, they give it to him. And Big Red has a 14-3 lead. This is how the nightmare defense looked to DeSales quarterback Jack Elgin, who may wake up in a cold sweat tonight. The misery continued in the third period. Elgin is slammed by Greg Bell and company. DeSales had all sorts of problems in that third period, like this shank punt. Time for a little more of the Tubbo Show. They might as well be chasing the wind. Steubenville was indeed the executioner tonight, 35-17, and they need two more victories to reach the state championship game.
In the regional final, Big Red would have to leave Harding Stadium for the first time since the loss at Warren Harding.
I got tired of hearing that. We have a better record away from home than we do at home at the playoffs. I think we're 2-2 at home, and we're 8-4 overall.
Big Red got the early breaks against Watterson and went on top 20-0 thanks to some good fortune. They needed the early cushion because Watterson had the most explosive passing offense that Steubenville saw all year. There were some extremely tense moments in the fourth quarter. But Big Red hung on for a 27-20 victory, which would send them back to Ohio Stadium in the state semifinal. The Big Red Machine put its most impressive performance of the year together in a 28-10 thumping of a fine Kettering Altar Club. It was the finest hour for two-year veteran quarterback Jamo Creech, who dazzled Altar with both his running and passing. It was a total showcase of all Big Red had to offer in 1987. 1,000-yard rusher Tubbo Yetz was joined in Big Red's slashing ground attack by brother Dunrick and fellow scatback Jimmy Kelly. In the second half, Big Red's nightmare defense picked the Kettering Altar offense clean to the bone. They would be back in Ohio Stadium 1 week later for a second shot at the Division II championship in 4 years. For the first time in 1987, Steubenville found itself in a battle with a team that was its physical equal. A long Buchtel drive resulted in a touchdown early in the second period to put them in front 6-0.
We preach to our kids all the time that you have to be able to take advantage of mistakes. And when you make a mistake, you have to be able to regroup.
Steubenville got the break it needed a short time later when Buchtel fumbled at their own 17-yard line. On third and goal from the 7, Tubbo Yetz did what he's done so well in his 2 years as a Big Red tailback. He found the end zone. Big Red went into the dressing room with a 7-6 halftime lead.
As the game was played in the first half, you can see where they were stronger than us and maybe as physical or more physical, but I felt as a coach that we could out-scrap them. And when we were winning 7-6, that's what I talked about at halftime was, 24 more minutes. You have to be as scrappy as you can for 24 more minutes.
Midway through the third quarter, one big play would determine Big Red's fate for the 1987 season. They appeared to have Ricky Powers trapped in the backfield, but he eluded the Big Red defenders and was off on a 71-yard touchdown jaunt to put Buchtel in front 12-7. Over the next 10-minute period, everything snowballed against Steubenville. Suddenly, what had been a close and hard-fought contest had turned into a 26-7 Buchtel runaway.
The thing that made me so happy after losing, and I don't know if you can be happy after losing, but when you're losing 26-7 and your kids block the extra point, I mean, they could have just went up and leaned on them and let them kick the extra point. But we had four kids in there blocking that extra point. And we came back and we scored and we were ready for the onside kick. And, I have strong beliefs. And I really, when it was 26-14 and we were onside kicking, I really believed we had a shot to win. And I think maybe it's because our kids spoil me because they never quit.
Steubenville was beaten 26-14. But it must be remembered that Big Red outlasted 142 other teams in Division II competition, and their great championship legacy is certain to continue in the future.
I see the future of Big Red football every year, depending on the type of seniors, on the type of work they're willing to do through July. I think that you set your tone and you set your habits, and you're a winner before the season starts. At the end of July, every coach knows if they're going to win or not. The key to our program is our administration. We got a fantastic administration from the superintendent down to the elementary principals. I mean, our administration backs our program. And we got great coaches in the elementary. We got great coaches in the junior high. We got principals that back football. Half of our administration's, you know, ex-coaches. So as soon as I get a couple losses, I'll probably get fired and they'll make me an administrator.
In the meantime, Reno Sukach and his outstanding Big Red coaching staff will continue to operate one of the most consistent and successful football programs anywhere.
On in the next several minutes. Let's begin with the other three playoff entrants. Some familiar faces from Tyler County and newcomers to postseason play, JU and Wheeling Park. A brand new era began at the park this season, and they got off to a dream start. The Patriots won their first six ball games before running into obstacles at the stadium against Parkersburg and Brook. The springboard to their success early in the season was the opening win against Wheeling Central, and a great confidence builder in week number two when they outlasted a quality Bel Air team in overtime 14-13. By week number four, the Patriots had their fans thinking about big things because their come-from-behind blowout of Warren Local was something to behold. They were getting a lot of productivity out of the seniors, and quarterback Eric McIntyre proved to be one of the most deadly trigger men in West Virginia. Sean Donaldson was his favorite target.
Some of these things that the seniors did this year, as far as working together and giving what we think everything, will be passed on down to the juniors. And I think that that type of togetherness and the type of team effort is what our team wants to be. And I think that that's going to, the success that we had is going to be carried on to the juniors and sophomores. And I think that will just kind of hopefully spread into our program.
The Patriots' playoff chances looked dim after two losses, and they were a physically battered team heading to Oak Glen in week nine. They got by the Golden Bears and squared off against John Marshall in the final week of the season, needing a win and some help elsewhere to get into the postseason. A masterful drive in the final minutes lifted the Patriots to victory over the Monarchs, and help was on the way as the park finished 8-2, securing a first-ever playoff berth. They played tough against top-ranked Stonewall in the opening round, but the fourth quarter proved disastrous, and the Patriots' most successful season would end.
We'd like to continue that.
First in school history, and moved the Raiders into the playoffs for the fourth time in five seasons. Unfortunately, they self-destructed offensively in the semifinal against Mate One, and were denied a shot at Madonna. The JU Yellow Jackets posted one of the big turnarounds in Ohio Valley history this year. In 1986, they were 2-8 and dead last in the OVAC race. This year, an 8-2 regular season propelled them into the playoffs, where a heavily favored opponent was waiting. Here's an amusing flashback to that night in Cambridge. One thing you gotta love is the support our teams get from their loyal fans. Here is the JU rooting section of some 2,000. Now let's introduce the fans of undefeated and number one ranked Columbus Academy. Columbus Academy would go on to an unbeaten season and a Division IV state title, but only one team played them tough in the postseason, and that was JU. The Yellow Jackets tied the game with 5 minutes to play before a late Academy drive iced it 21-14. It was a season John Kuzakowski and the JU fans will remember for all times. The Lensley Cadets cannot go to the playoffs under the current system. We know Brooke had the best team in West Virginia. Would you believe this might have been the next best team regardless of class? Don't laugh. Two of their victims finished with 9-1 records, including a big, ugly Western Reserve team. Kiske Preps coach Chuck Clossing had a 60-game winning streak on the high school level that ended upon the arrival of Lensley. The Cadets won the OVAC 3A title, and next year will take a 22-game streak of their own into battle. The group of seniors on this team backs. This is the Ohio Valley's second leading all-time passer, Todd Antill of Shadyside. He too was a starter for 4 years in orange and black and led the Tigers to the brink of the 87 playoffs. After the sixth week of the season, the River Pilots looked like a playoff team. They were leading the Division III Region 11 computer rankings, but the injury demons wrecked the party again. The Pilots suffered key injuries to three of their four captains, Garen Gowdy, Chris Beam, and Mike Williams, and lost three of their last four outings. Despite these obstacles, Terry Snively's Pilots salvaged a 7-3 campaign. Buckeye South pulled off a major turnaround this year under Ron Poblish from 2-8 in 86 to 7-3. Highlights of the season included a win over rival Buckeye North to knock the Huskies out of playoff contention and a victory at playoff-bound JU in the final week. North had another fine year with Rich Weiskircher at the helm. Senior back Billy Kidd paced a consistent ground attack, which led the Huskies to a 7-3 finish. Since Weiskircher took the job, North has won 27 out of 30 regular season games. Bishop Donahue captured its fifth consecutive winning season under Rick Blake, posting a fine 7-3 mark. They too could have beaten several of the teams which made the playoffs. Their only losses were a pair of 6-0 decisions to unbeaten's Madonna and Tyler, plus a season-ending loss to 9-1 Valley. Tony Riley was named first-team All-State off their squad. The Union Local Jets finished 7-3 under the direction of Jake Olsavsky. The Jets earned a reputation as a solid defensive squad with some hard-hitting dudes. And finally, we have the Mingo Indians, who made an amazing recovery off an 0-10 1986 season. Mike Herrick's tribe won 5 of its last 6 games down the stretch to finish at 7-3, and they will return a lot of experienced vets next year, including a big, strong-armed quarterback named Bill Seach. As we said at the top of the show, this was probably the most balanced season of good football teams in Ohio Valley history.
Mark of a Champion was brought to you in part by Wheeling National Bank. All the bank you'll ever need. By Simon's Furniture, Simon's Thomasville Gallery, and Simon's Carpet Town of Weirton. And by Palomino Ford of Wellsburg, where every day is a sales day. By Advanced Federal Savings and Loan with offices in Wellsburg and Follinsby. And by Saxon Jewelers, downtown Steubenville and Fort Steuben Mall. Spend like